there was this friend of mine, and he is. He's a dentist, and he's a, you know, he's a real hip-type dentist, and a good one. And he says, you know, one of the big jokes, you never hear about intramural dentist jokes. I mean, dentists talk about, you know, little things they sit around. When four or five dentists are sitting around having a cup of tea, you know, a little Jack Daniels. What do they talk about? You know, they talk, oh, boy, you should have seen the one the other day. Had roots all the way down into her feet. Oh, my God. You know, what they say. See, he says, well, a standard joke, of course, among dentists is always the hypothetical dentist that pulls the hypothetical wrong tooth. And he says, you know, it's a standard joke. You know, nobody ever, like among radio guys, a standard joke is the thing that one day somebody said once in Pittsburgh on the radio when he thought his microphone was off. And everybody cackles. But you never meet the guy who actually said it. He's always hypothetical. He's a guy once I knew in kind of thing. And I might point out, that's all part of what we call in the trade the Uncle Don myth. Now, the Uncle Don myth is mythical. It's like, you know, it's like Icarus flying up there by the sun, you know, with his wax wings flapping. Now, you can sit around and say all you want about Icarus, or is it Icarus, which do you prefer? I mean, you know, you can jabber around all you want, but damn few people can say, well, I was there today, he did it, I saw them wings, and he had them wax wings, and I told them, you know. But no, not at all. It's a myth, you see. That's what makes it a groovy thing. And I would like to point out that every city I've ever been in, whenever radio guys gather, and the radio listener types occasionally do, there is somebody pointed out on a street corner, usually either selling newspapers, pencils, sometimes apples. Once in a while, he's selling shoelaces on the corner, a little old man with black glasses. And he's often pointed out to me as being the original Uncle Don, who said that'll hold the little you-know-whats when he thought his microphone was off after he concluded his kid program. Now, this so-called event is reputed to have occurred, Nick, in the following cities: Cleveland, Cincinnati, twice in Los Angeles, once in New York, and four times minimum in New York City. And it even is rumored that it once happened in Indianapolis, all by a man named Uncle Don. Now, if you were to line up all the radio listeners who claim they heard it happen, I would like to suggest now that those listeners, all standing with their hands close to their body, scrunched up next to the one guy, next to the next one, next to the next one, would form a line that could girdle the globe a minimum of 7.5 times, which means that hypothetical Uncle Don had a listening audience roughly tantamount, I would suggest, at this point, to four Super Bowl games rolled into one, which belies belief. But nevertheless, oh yes, I would like to know how many people were listening to a football game when they heard the announcement of Pearl Harbor. This is another great, vast multitude. Must be 100, 200, maybe 300 million people at least were listening to that football game. And so this is all part of mythology. It's all, you know, part of mythology. And the one thing that's interesting about it is that nobody has ever been able to pinpoint the actual Uncle Don or where he said it, right? Well, this is true of dentists. So dentists are always talking about a dentist once they heard of who did that, you know what, with the wrong tooth. Well, my friend told me the other day, this dentist friend of mine, he was ashen, he was shaking. And I said, what's the matter, John? And he said, well, I don't know how to tell you. And I said, well, what happened, John? He said, well, you heard me talk about Wesley. And I said, yes, I have heard you talk about Wesley. Wesley is the cut-up dentist. You see, among any group of professional men, there's always the guy who is more or less the, let's put it this way, he's a barrel of fun type. You know, there's one doctor who comes in and walks up behind another doctor and says, boo, what is this? And with that, he whips out a fresh set of just freshly removed appendices and whips them down into his doctor friend's, he's eating funiculi with tomato sauce. And the next thing you know, he's got, you know, oh, yeah, that's Dr. Humor. I'm just telling you what Dr. Humor's like. Oh, yeah, yeah. That's right. Don't worry, honey, I'll do that. I know of one doctor one time who who gave another doctor as a Christmas gift. He gave him a beautiful set of preserved adenoids, which were in a nice bottle of formaldehyde and wrapped in gift wrapper. Yeah, you know, that's the kind of humor. I'm sorry. That's the kind of stuff that people do, you know. Don't blame me. I don't make the news. I just report it. Yeah. This is WOR New York, as if you couldn't guess. All right, my friend John, see, he says, you know, Wesley. And I said, yeah, I heard you talk about Wesley. He's, you know, Wesley's the funny dentist, see. And he's the kind, you know, who's always giving his dental assistant a hot foot. That kind, pretending he's giving her pentothal, and he comes running in with a great big, yeah, he says one of the things he did one time give one, he has a very nervous patient, you know, some people are very nervous about dentists, you know, and it's a very nervous guy who wears celluloid collars and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, he says there's guys that still do that. He said they're very nervous guys. He looks like a character out of Dickens. He's bald head, high, wears little bow ties with celluloid collars. And he's very nervous about the dentist, but very tight-lipped, as if nothing bothers him. And yet he says he can see stark fear in his eyes. So one day, Dr. Wesley, wearing his jazzy white coat, you know, being the dentist, he has this mirror on top, and he lowers the light down over the nervous patient. And he says, Miss Mortimer, please, would you... Please handle me nut pick number two. And she gives him nut pick number two, and he digs in his mouth. He says, light, please. He lowers the light a little bit. Then he says, hypodermic, please. And he reaches behind him. She hands him this hypodermic. Well, he has a veterinary friend. And the veterinary friend had given him a hypodermic, the kind they use on hippopotamuses. You know, when a hippopotamus has bad joints or something. A tremendous, fantastic, gigantic, lethal-looking, totally deadly-looking hypodermic. Weighed about 7 pounds, came in a shoulder holster, had a needle at least 14 inches long with prongs on it, you know. And he takes this thing out, see, and he says, he just holds it up like that. He's going to stick this guy. He says, the guy is being tight-lipped, see. He doesn't want to pretend nothing's happening, see. And he says, he sees the pupils of his eyes contract. With the total fear, but he's sitting there very tight. He says he could hear his jockey shorts going twang, twang, out of fear. And he says, gigantic thing. And he plays it absolutely cool, see. And he says, Miss Mortimer, 225cc, please, solution number 12. But she turns around with the hypodermic. She's got a great big jug, and she goes, sucks it all up in the hypodermic. And he had made this purple, green, gloppy-looking solution, see? Well, all right, that's the kind of humor this guy's got. Okay, you can see, it's really basic bad news humor, right? I mean, you know, that's the kind of stuff. So they had a good laugh, you know, and they sat around and drank Lavoras for half an hour and got bombed out of their skull, and you know how it is. So, nevertheless, this same guy, my friend John, says, well, you know how Wes is, you know. And I said, yeah, I do know how Wes is. He said, well, he says, you know, Wes is always playing gags, right? And I says, well, I don't know. I mean, if you can call that giant hypodermic a gag, you know, I don't know. I mean, looks like he's got a little Adolf Eichmann blood in him, see, or something. And he says, you know what happened to Wes the other day? And I said, no. He says, well, Wes has got this very elegant lady, you know, who comes in there all the time, and he's been working on this case, and he has all the x-rays out. And Wes is about to start work again. She's been coming in there like 15 times. And so he gets to go. He gets working away there. And he's extracting a tooth. You got it, right? Extracting a tooth. He says, so he gets everything ready. He gets everything gone away. He gets all the stuff, the anesthesia going, everything like that. Everything's going groovy, see? So he reaches in. He goes, that's it. That's neat, see? Everything worked just according to Hoyle. So he puts all his stuff back into the tray, you know, and the girl is, all of a sudden, Miss Mortar comes over and says, Dr. Wes, and he says, yes. She says, the wrong one. He says, the wrong what? She says, the wrong one. You pulled the number 6 SJ7 incisor. It was the number 6 SJ7 GT incisor. He says, what do you mean? You pulled the wrong one. It was then that he realized what he had done. That horrible moment. He had the names alphabetically, all neatly, in his X-ray file. And he had pulled out the one right next to hers alphabetically. And he had pulled the wrong tooth. And
there she's laying there, see?
I says, John, what happened then? What did he do? He says, don't ask. I says, I won't. And so I would like to tell you, friends, I ask. I don't know what happened at that point. All I know is that the thing that Wes had always been laughing about all the other dentists, see, every time he would meet another dentist, he'd say, pull any wrong tooth lately? Wes is the only guy who actually did it. So I want to tell you, friends, there's a lesson in this for all of us. There's a real lesson in it for all of us. And that is, don't horse around. That's a shepherd's lesson for today. Would you please listen to that? Don't horse around. Now, I could just be horsed around here, you know, and pretending like I was Uncle Don. And, wouldn't it be funny if I said, don't horse around. Do not horse around. Did I ever tell you about the friend that I knew? The friend of mine who is to this day, his life is ruined to this day. Ruined because he horsed around. Horsing around. You get into trouble, more trouble, horsing around than any other thing. Yeah, any other thing. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you one thing. A friend of mine who is now working in Chicago, by the way, he's got a big TV show there. And I know, God knows where he could have gone if he hadn't done this. I mean, he could have gone. He could be working in, some big place by now. But he, yeah, that's right. You know what he did? He was doing the morning news. He was a staff announcer, you know. And he was doing the morning news on this radio station. And he'd come in every morning, like at 6 o'clock, you know, he'd at 5 a.m. And he'd do the 6 o'clock news. They had this big morning show, see, and he'd do the 6 o'clock news, and he'd do the 7 o'clock news. No 5-minute newscast, you know, just strictly staff. Well, the big newscaster came on at 8, you know, the big guy, you know, like Lyle Vann on the human side of the news. You know, some big type announcer would come in and do the news. You know, newscaster, that's different from an announcer. So he's sitting around there, he's bored, you know, it's 7:45, and this guy was a real stiff. Totally stuffed shirt type, you know, the guy that comes on at 8. Yeah, he was the kind of guy that clears his throat for 15-20 minutes before he goes on. And he has little megaphones attached to his ears so he can hear his own voice, you know. 1, 2, 3, 4. Good morning, Americans. He'd practice it. Yeah, he'd sit in his little room in there. He had a room, attached to the news machines. He'd say things like, good afternoon, Americans. And he's very good at that kind of thing. Went on to become very big, and now he says it even more. He's on the network and everything now, the same guy, see. He says, good afternoon, Americans everywhere. That kind of thing. He's got elegant style, see. Or one of his great lines is, are we, the American taxpayers, consulted? And so ends my open letter to the president. Good afternoon, Americans everywhere. He's always writing open letters to the president, you know. That takes guts. But nevertheless, he's that type, see? So and thoroughly hated, by the way, by the rest of the staff. He was such a totally pompous fake Newton that, he made your teeth squeak just to look at him. Yeah, he had, he put starch in his Fruit of the Loom shorts, you know, that kind of a guy. You know, he's very, very, very square John. So nevertheless, my friend Wally, we will call him that for want of a better name. Yes, he's a real pippy-poo type. He's sitting at the typewriter in the newsroom waiting for his shift to end. He's been on since about 3 in the morning, bored out of his bird and half asleep. And he types up this bulletin. Just a bulletin. You'd think anybody would realize it's a gag. You know, he types it up on newspaper. It says, Washington, all National Guard and all training units and all units of the U.S. Army were today mobilized at 7 a.m., period. By order of the president, period. That's it. He just left it there. See, well, not anyone, you know, come on. That would be all over the news. You know, that would be in 5,000 reams a copy. Bells would ring everywhere if that happened, right? Well, do I have to ask you what Square John did? No, well, he didn't do what you thought he did. He didn't come in and put it on the air. No. He got this thing, see? Well, he thinks he's very important. See, the one thing about Square Johns is they always think everybody's spying on them. Yes, this is a form of ego to believe the FBI is spying on you. You have to think of yourself as very important to believe that the FBI would be spying on you. You know, this is for you. Oh, yeah, that's a kind of a paranoia. So it's a self-involvement to believe that J. Edgar Hoover, the FBI, the CIA, everybody's spying on you. You know, that means you're a really important guy. So anyway, he comes in there and he finds this note. What do you think he did? He called the FBI and said that a saboteur has placed in his news files an erroneous false message which would cause panic in the United States. Now, wait a minute. This guy's on a little 250-watt peanut whistle in Midwest. Can you imagine planting a panic in the United States? That's how important he thought his newscast would cause panic. People would run out of the streets. Oh, we are being attacked. Did you hear the 8 a.m. news? Oh, we're being attacked. 251. We were down, our station was so far down the dial at that time, Nick, that our listening audience competed rather unfavorably with the police calls. And then, in fact, we were down around in that frequency. I think we were just about this side of shortwave. We were down there where there were little birdies and whistles, you know, and once in a while you'd hear radiators banging in the background, all kinds of noises. So anyway, he called the FBI. Within 5 minutes, the 18 agents come, you know, after all, it's a radio station, and they go out, they powder things on, you know, to find out where the, you know, where all the while, Wally's back home in his room in the Y. You know, he's trying to get some sleep. He figures his little gag, and that's the end of it, see? Well, 15 minutes later, I don't have to tell you what happened. Yes, indeed. So, yeah, they yank him out, you know, he's a saboteur and all this stuff, you know, he's trying to panic the United States. Well, nevertheless, then what is this from? Horsing around. All right, tonight's show is about that elusive human thing called horsing around. Now, I submit to you, the guy with a bulldozer might have been horsing around. I imagine for years. These guys with the bulldozer say, what do you think, Charlie? One day, you know, we knocked down a wrong house, you know, Well, horsing around. Now, I'm going to tell you a terrible story. This is a true story, and I'm going to tell it to you, and I'm going to lay it out just the way it was. And it's the ultimate horsing around horror story. The ultimate horsing around horror story. And incidentally, may I point out that horsing around is often the direct product of boredom. Yeah, you know it, man. Oh, you know it. You sit around and master control long enough, and you're bored out of your bean. You know, you can hear your head. You can actually hear it turning to sauerkraut. You know, your brain is beginning to ferment. That with just plain stagnation, you are a human swamp, brackish water. And have you ever had the feeling your head has been asleep for a while, you know? Once in a while, you can hear a bubble in your brain, bloop, and up comes this rare poison gas that seeps out of your ears, you know? Well, nevertheless, this is the ultimate thing. This is what causes horsing around. And because it's a desire, a secret desire to blow up the place is what really it stems from. Well, where is boredom raised to a fine art? I mean, outside of, you know, the 24th floor here. I mean, where is boredom raised to a fine art? That's right. You are correct, Demo. I discovered new dimensions in boredom when I was in the Army. No, there ain't no civilian can even remotely touch on the subject of boredom when he's around anyone who has spent any time, any length of time, in any one of the major services. I mean, because boredom, I can remember, you know, being so bored, you reach a point in boredom where you don't even know you're bored anymore. It's just like does a hamster know it's a hamster just squatting in a cage, eating seeds, you know, year after year, just squatting and belching and that's it? A hamster? No! Have you ever looked at an animal and say, what? you know, gee, it must be boring just to be a dog. What is a dog? Does he just walk around? Doesn't he ever read? No, you know, see, he's so bored of it. His boredom is so profound that he doesn't even know he's bored anymore. Well, that's the way it is in the Army a lot of times, see? Well, a few years ago, when I was working in another city, and I'm not going to tell you the name of the city, I was broadcasting. I did a nightly, like a nightclub show. See, I never did studio stuff much, and I was always doing on-stage broadcasts and stuff, you know, like the Limelight and that. And I was broadcasting from a big nightclub restaurant in this city. And it was a big show, and, you know, live up on stage and all that stuff. And the guy that ran it, that ran this place, he had a curious, morose quality about him. I couldn't pinpoint it. Now, the place would be filled with, riotous customers buying everything but the tablecloths, you know, which they stole. Just squirting money, and he'd still walk around. He had a morose look in the eye, see. So one night, after the show, I'm sitting there, we're through. See, the place is emptied out, and I walk down through the empty tables after the show and is over, and the guys are sweeping up, and I'm walking through the tables, and all of a sudden I see over in the corner, I see Cy sitting over there. See, I'll call him Cy, okay? You know, it's a silly reason to call him that. Well, actually, his name was Cy, but I see Cy sitting over there in the corner, and I said, "How are you, Cy?" See, and he said, "Okay." And we had a great night. You know, the place had been packed. I said, you know, money flowing in, people yelling and screaming, drinking champagne out of slippers and the whole bit, you know. And I said, "How are you, Cy? What, you know, what's up?" He said, "Sit down and have a drink." So I said, "Yeah, okay, Cy." And see, this is one of the punishments of working in nightclubs. You always got to have a drink with a boss. And, you know, due to the fact that it's such an ingrained habit with him, he instinctively waters your drink, even when you're having one with him, see. So I sit down there, and he says, "What do you have?" And I says, "Jack Daniel." Well, I knew I wasn't going to get that. You know, it's a bar whiskey that his friend Fred W. Barr makes in his basement down the street, see. And, you know, they make it out of pure alky, you know. They put a little caramel syrup in it, you know, and OD bourbon. And I'm sitting there drinking this Rotgutten, I finally came out with it. I said, "Cy, what's eating you anyway?" I says, "It's late at night. I was feeling pretty good, so I figured, well, what the hell? Let's blow the gaff." I said, what's bugging you anyway? Why is it?" He said, "What do you mean?" That's what, you know, Cy, I said, "I know you a long time, and you walk around here, you know, and in the middle of everything, guys are hitting you on the back and screaming and yelling, you know, and you got the biggest thing in this town since bottled beer, and the Copa would be jealous of you. What's bugging you?" "I don't know what you mean." I said, "Well, okay, Cy, you don't want to talk about it. All right, it's over to me. It's okay, you know. There's nothing that makes a guy want to talk quicker than to pretend you don't give a damn about it." See, I was beginning to discover that principle, so I says, "All right, okay." It's probably dull anyway, you know. Boring story. "How about another drink, Cy?" That's what he says. Hey, Luigi, another drink here. By the way, when he called the waiter Luigi, that means water at double. If he called him Fernando, that means, you know, slip a Mickey in it. So he says, "Hey, Luigi, another one here for Shep here." So I'm sitting there waiting, and then he's all right. He says, "I'll tell you what it is. I'll tell you. He says, I was in the Army." I said, "Yeah, so was I, Cy." He said, "Well, you know how bored you get in the Army?" And I says, "Yes, Cy, I do." He says, "Well, I'll tell you." He says, I was assigned to an island. And he said, it was just a little island way out in the middle of the Pacific. Me and another bunch of guys, about 25 guys, in a Signal Corps radio teletype relay company. And I said, "Oh, God." He says, "Yeah, you have no idea. Relay. We didn't even invent messages. We relayed them." He says, "That's all." He says, "And there was nothing else on the island." He says, "There were a couple of toads." He says, "There were half a dozen guinea pigs running around." He said, "They have big guinea pigs out there." "Yeah, they really do, you know, out the Pacific. Did you know that? They got big fat rodents." And he says, they were all male, which even made it worse. He said, you know, any female guinea pigs. And he says, and there was no beach. He says, everybody thinks of the South Pacific as a beach, you know? No beach. He says, nothing but cliffs all around. He says, if you ever tried to swim, forget it. Between the sharks and the fact that the water was filled with little sharp things that cut your feet, he says, there was no beach. There was nothing. He says, it was 150 degrees there all the time. And he said, when it wasn't 150 degrees, it was 190. And when it wasn't 190, it was raining. And then it was 210. He says, it actually rained the boiling water. He says, we're sitting there. He says, the first year goes by, and he said, one ship went by us. He says, we could see it out on the horizon, like 400 miles away, and everybody went down to the cliff and looked at it through spy glasses. It was a ship passing on the horizon. I said, where did it go? He says, I don't know. It just went over the horizon and disappeared. Never come there. I said, well, how did you get your supplies? He says, once every 6 months, a whole bunch of planes would fly over and drop stuff on them. He says, most of it would go in the ocean. I said, well, how long were you there? He says, well, he says, I was there going on to 3 years. And he says, now I want to tell you, it was unbelievable. He said, so one morning, he says, it's like 5 minutes to 7 in the morning. I'm sitting there at the teletype machine, and the messages are coming in and going out. They go... They go from the War Department, and they go out to MacArthur. Ding, 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 ding. He says, now I'm watching the thing. Ding, ding, ding. And I'm running the machine, that's all. It's just going on and on through. And he says, now we had a teletype. We could type a message if we wanted to and put it in on the line. He said, and we had these machines all sitting around with keyboards on them. He said, and so my friend Aki is sitting on the other side of the tent, and he's got a keyboard, right? He says, so we plug it up so that I can send the message to Aki. And so Aki is sending me dirty stories on his teletype, see? And it goes ding, 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 and I'd laugh, see? So I send him a dirty story. Ding, 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 and they're going back and forth, see? He said, so Aki gets a real funny idea. He goes ding, 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 ding. Today, 17 GIs blew up General MacArthur. Ding, 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 ding. And he says, ah, we laugh at that one, see? So I think of a funny joke. So I say, ding, 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 ding. Today, the war ended all over the world. Ding, 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 report. Hitler has surrendered. Ding, 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 signed Ike. Ding, 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 General Eisenhower. Ding, 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 the war in Europe is over. Ding, 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 6SJ7. And he signs the secret War Department code, which means high priority message all the way to the Supreme Headquarters. He thought it was a gag, see? And he just sent it over to his friend Aki. Aki left and left it in the machine. They go off shift. Now they're laying in their tent asleep, see? It is now 8:30 in the morning. They go off the shift at 8. When all of a sudden my friend wakes up with the sweat pouring and he hears cannon fire. Boom! Pow! Pow! He hears guys go, woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! Boom! 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 He wakes up and across the tent from him is Aki. He says, Aki, Aki. Aki says, what are you doing? Boom, boom. He says, Aki, listen, they're firing at our island. What the hell's going on? Aki opens the tent and looks out, and he sees a lot of naked GIs running around shooting their 45s up in the air. Kapow, pow, they're screaming. The lieutenant is running, throwing his helmet up in the air. And Aki wanders out and says, what's the matter? And the guy says, didn't you hear, Aki? The war is over. It's over. We get the message from the Supreme Headquarters. And Aki says, yeah, really? And for 5 minutes, Aki celebrated. And then it hit him. It was his message. And the reports are filtering through. Somebody came into the tent at 8 o'clock in the morning, saw that message in Aki's teletype machine. It says, for crying out loud, you mean them nuts last night didn't relay this on? He says, they tore it up, they relayed it on to Eisenhower, they relayed it on to General MacArthur, to Admiral Nimitz, and all over the Pacific, guys are celebrating, blowing up bombs and everything. And the war was no more over, friend, than 1972 is over. And they had started the whole damn thing. Horsing around. Well, the people are cheering. Guys are running around saying, well, look at home. Oh, my God. And my friend Cy goes down to the headquarters tent. And sitting in there is their captain, bombed out of his skull. He's drinking, yelling, "Sit down, sign, the war's over. How are you, boy?" And Cy says, "Well, Captain, that's what I come to talk to you about." He says, "What do you mean, come to talk to me? Sit down, Cy. Hey, Cy, how about a drink? Hey, Cy, I'm going to make you a captain. Come on, what the hell, the war's over." He says, "Wait a minute, Captain. Excuse me, Captain, about that message. About that message, And outside, the ships of now, Nimitz's fleet is coming over the horizon, firing its guns in celebration. Kaboom! Kaboom! Star shells are going up. Planes are flying overhead doing barrel rolls. You know, the guy's just... You spot that message, Captain. don't get mad now. It's just, you know, one thing about you, Cap, you know, honestly, you got a sense of humor, right? That message, I typed it out and sent it to Aki. He says, "Well, yeah, well, why don't you send it on to headquarters, for crying out loud? It's the only thing going..." He says, "No, I just typed it. I invented it." I sent it to Aki. He said, "You what?" He said, "I sent it to Aki." He said, "Oh, my God, quick, get MacArthur on the phone." End of story. This is WOR New York. Stay tuned for Lester Smith in the news. His